Bigger picture, former senior White House officials have reportedly cautioned that President Trump would have no guardrails if reelected. The so-called adults in the room will all be gone. He'll mostly surround himself with yes men and women. You told CNN earlier this week, quote, "I think we can repair the damage of one Trump term. I'm not so certain about repairing the damage of two." Why? What do you think he would do in a second term? Would he withdraw from NATO altogether? Would he pull out all U.S. troops from South Korea and Japan and Germany? What are you most afraid of?
Well, all of those things are true, and there are a range of national security concerns I have. I also am concerned as a lifelong conservative Republican that once he no longer needs a reelection, once he no longer needs the people to come out and vote him in, there's really no limit on what he might do in a second term. I can give you an example. One of the liberal justices on the Supreme Court may leave, and he may be advised by some of his closest advisors that the balance of the court would be a great legacy for him. He appointed some great conservative justices in the first term, now appoint some great liberal justices and leave that balance. What a legacy that would be. I could see him doing it. The point is, he in many cases made substantive policy decisions on national security matters because of the expected domestic political reaction. Now, all presidents take politics into account. Nobody I've ever seen like Trump. Once he doesn't have to worry about that political reaction, I worry about the consequences.
You're right that President Trump was so eager to make a deal with China that he was willing to give up important national security priorities involving Chinese telecom companies ZTE and Huawei. You also write that the president asked Chinese President Xi to help him win re-election by entering into that trade deal that could theoretically include ZTE and Huawei. You didn't really connect the two, but aren't you basically saying that President Trump was willing to sell out American national security interests in exchange for China helping him win re-election? Isn't that basically the conclusion of that information that you provide in your book?
Well, I would characterize it this way. I think the kinds of things the president did, his casual granting of essentially personal favors to some of these authoritarian leaders in the case of Huawei and ZTE involving potential criminal prosecutions, was a way that he took legitimate government power and used it for his own personal advancement. And I think he has trouble seeing the difference between his personal interest and the interest of the government of the United States. So I try and recount these examples in the book so people can draw their own conclusions. But I was obviously very troubled by it, and I think people should be troubled by it.
Do you think President Trump has placed his personal financial interests ahead of the national interest?
You know, I don't see evidence of the financial interest point. I know that concerns a lot of people. Maybe there is evidence of it. But to me, the corruption was the political corruption of using legitimate government power to advance his own political fortunes. Now, once again, I'm not saying that presidents can make decisions in the complete absence of political factors. Obviously, that's not true. But there's a line that can be crossed, and I think it has been crossed here, where the political factors dominate everything else.
Do you think President Trump poses a clear and present danger to the nation?
Look, that's a buzz phrase. I think he's dangerous enough he shouldn't get a second term.